who your friends are and who's going to be out there with a gun and putting two behind your ear. The higher you get in the mob, the bigger the bullseye circle becomes on your chest.
You might forgive Vito Rizzuto for a little overconfidence. 25 years had passed since the triple murder in New York that cemented his reputation and career. He was Canada's Teflon Don, apparently even to the authorities. In 25 years, the best the Canadians could do was to get Rizzuto to settle a minor tax case. But south of the border, it was a different story.
And it started with one of the greatest law enforcement operations ever. In the mid-1970s, the FBI managed to insert one of its own agents inside the Bonanno crime family. Someone who gained the trust of some of the most cunning and homicidal men in America. Something never done before or since.
Well, the reason it's so difficult to infiltrate the American mafia is because you have to have known somebody. Everybody knows somebody. You know, everybody has a cousin, everybody has a friend. You have to have grown up in one of the neighborhoods. You have to have somebody, as they say, vouch for you.
Our mafia expert Joe Pistone should know. He was the FBI agent who spent six perilous years as a Bonanno soldier. That's him on the right in his undercover identity. Pistone's story was told in a movie by 20th Century Fox. The title was his mob name, Donnie Brasco.
Okay, when I introduce you, I'm gonna say, this is a friend of mine. That means you're a connected guy. Now, if I said instead, this is a friend of ours, that would mean you were a made guy. A capiche?
Yeah, friend of mine, friend of ours. Yeah. What do I call you, friend of ours?
Or... Keep your fucking mouth shut about me. Don't say, hey, Donnie.
Johnny Depp plays the title role of Donnie Brasco. Al Pacino is his mafia mentor.
Some things I gotta take.
Yeah. What do you want, 100?
Yeah, what are you doing? Wise guy don't carry his money in a wallet. Hey, wise guy carries money in a roll, like this. See? Beena on the outside. Like that. Come on.
What Pistone did and the way he was able to do it for so many years is certainly, you know, it was huge, and it was an incredible event, a credible doing, undertaking by him.
And the repercussions of that landmark FBI operation are felt in gangland to this day. Though the mob put a price on Pistone's head, he survived to testify in more than 100 criminal trials. Bit by bit, the mafia's code of silence crumbled, and the dominoes started to fall. They led all the way to the man who ordered Vito Rizzuto to pull the trigger at that social club in 1981, the then Don of the Bonanno crime family, Joe Massino.
Well, I always said there's no honor amongst thieves, and that proves it out there.
Found guilty of murder, incredibly, even Massino, the one-time boss of bosses, began to talk.
You know, here he gets convicted. He's facing a death penalty, facing a loss of $10 million or so in a civil suit. And the first thing he does is he goes to the authorities and says, I'll do A, B, and C, you know. If you cut me a break, cut me the death penalty.
Massino fingered Vito Rizzuto as the trigger man in the 1981 killings. The Americans charged him with conspiracy to commit murder. After fighting extradition for 2 years, he was driven from prison to Montreal's Trudeau Airport. Waiting on the tarmac were an executive jet and FBI agents. Before long, he would be in a U.S. federal penitentiary, sentenced to 10 years. But before he left, Vito Rizzuto had a prediction.
He turned to the cop and he goes, you know, this is a big mistake. This place isn't going to be the same when I'm gone. So there's no glue left holding the family together.
When we come back, the extraordinary tale of the tapes.
There's no fucking money. There's no money. They don't give me time to finish this off.
And what happens when the mob calls you?
I want my fucking money. Today, Lorenzo says he's gonna grab you, he's gonna fucking turn you into a pretzel.
It was 2006, and the Don was gone. Vito Rizzuto had been extradited to the U.S. and sentenced to 10 years in prison for his role in the mob murders 25 years before. It was especially bad news at this coffee shop in Montreal's North End. For decades, the Consensus Social Club had been Rizzuto World Headquarters. But for the family, things were about to get even worse, because the task force investigating organized crime in Montreal, called Project Colisée, had discovered a way to get inside the Consensus.
The policemen were very surprised because they discovered that during the night there was nobody were inside the Consensus Club as a security man. You know, the security man was leaving in the middle of the night, and somebody else arrived a few hours later.
In other words, a few hours in which it was possible to access the club and install state-of-the-art microphones and video cameras in the ceiling.
It was a joint operation by the RCMP, Montreal, and Quebec Provincial Police Forces, known as the Combined Forces Special Enforcement Unit. One morning in June 2003, they turned on the microphones and cameras at the Consensus Social Club and began to listen and watch.
For more than 3 years, before and after the extradition of Vito Rizzuto, police would eavesdrop on 1.2 million conversations.
There's no fucking money. There's no money. They don't give me time to finish this off.
What emerged was an unprecedented inside view of Canada's most powerful and profitable criminal family.
And they thought that they were protected within it. It was their bolt hole. It was their home hearth for business. And everything you needed to know about that family was on those tapes.
For example?
Well, how much money came in, where the money came from, who the money went to, how the money got out, who's going to get a slap in the head, who's going to get a slap in the back, you know, shot or just beaten.
At the Consensus, there are two main areas. The outer coffee bar, where family members and visitors socialize and talk, and the back room, where the real business is done. Here, the main man is Vito's father, Nick Sr.
Nick Rizzuto was seen at Café Cosenza almost every day for 4 years. He was there hanging around, discussing with people, playing cards with others.
With Vito in prison, the tapes show the 82-year-old patriarch acting as boss of the family.
He settled conflicts that occurred in the bookmaking activities of the organization, and he received there at the Cosenza his share of the money that was given in the small office at the Café Cosenza.
On a typical morning, Nick Rizzuto Sr. received a succession of visitors bearing cash, paying tribute, they called it.
Each captain has to give a percentage, whatever the boss determines every week, to the family kitty. And the thing is that all the money goes up. So, you know, the boss has coming into his chest, you know, every month, millions and millions, because he gets a cut of everything.
When he gets his cut, Nick Rizzuto's first question is, how much? And he always counts the cash twice, taking two bundles, one for himself, one for his absent son, Vito, both put into his sock.
It was at times hilarious. I mean, Nick, the video of Nick stuffing money into his sock, this old bald man pulling up his pants. Nick trying to count what bills he's got and trying to make sure nobody else got more than him. I'll take this for my son. I'll take this for my grand. You know, it was like, sometimes there were six guys in the room and there were 45 hands. And they're all just grabbing on this money.
So if you have, you know, 15 capos that are giving you $10,000 a month, and then you're getting a piece of the action from every illegal activity, that's a lot of money going into that boss's treasure chest. The money's mind-boggling. It's just millions and millions of dollars a year.
And the scope of the illegality directed from the Consensus back room was breathtaking, too.
They were involved in a variety of criminal activities, ranging from importation of cocaine through the airport of Montreal, importation of cocaine using containers, bookmaking, gambling, extortion, possession of proceeds of crime, gangsterism, a wide variety of criminal activities.
For example, the wiretaps revealed something astounding at Montreal's Trudeau Airport. The Rizzutos had a dozen people there on their payroll, from baggage handlers to customs agents. Police cameras caught couriers arriving at the airport for a Caribbean cocaine run and recorded their financial arrangements.
Hey, about the money, let me tell you about the money. Okay, you gave me $120,000. Something like that. Remember?
It's amazing, and I'd say it's troubling to see that an organization has infiltrated the International Airport of Montreal. It's troubling.
The woman on this surveillance tape is a customs officer. A court found she was supplying pre-stamped customs declaration forms to help drug couriers, like this man, avoid being searched upon their return to Canada.
I have the paper already. I stamped it myself, and he gave me the code, the green light code.
Yeah, this time I said, don't worry.
This is fucking easy, man.
However easy the Rizzutos made it look, the surveillance tapes revealed that a lot of their work is done by telephone. When you listen to the recordings, remember, they're not actors reading a script. They're real-life professional gangsters relying on a well-honed, time-honored technique, intimidation.
Bro, you gotta give me money today.
Day?
Yeah.
Come on, man. Let me talk to you. Where are you? Can I see you?
The unlucky recipient of this call owes a gambling debt of $112,000.
I'm not waiting after today. After today, my partner said he's going to come and he's going to break every limb in your body. I want $112,000 today.
Come on. Okay? You serious, bro?
We're going to come and get you in your fucking house. I don't give a fuck. I want 112 G's today, or bro, where we catch you, we're going to leave you.
The Rizzuto's chief enforcer is Frank Del Balso.
I want my fucking money. Today, Lorenzo says he's gonna grab you, he's gonna fucking turn you into a pretzel. And don't fuck with him, bro.
I don't wanna fuck with nobody, man.
Listen to me. Go get 112 dimes and you save yourself a fucking beating of your life.
Offers hard to refuse aren't only for deadbeat gamblers. An overdue notice from a Rizzuto-connected company brings a customer service call like this.
Yeah, you know when you're going to pay the bill?
Who are you?
Eh?
Who are you?
The guy that's going to make you eat out of a straw for 6 months if you don't go pay him.
I beg your pardon?
You hear me? I know you have me on tape. Don't worry about it. Just go pay the bill, okay? And I'm not going to come and tell you again. The next time I break your head.
Even seemingly legitimate transactions could take a thuggish turn. The Rizzutos invested $5 million with a firm called Norshield on an upper floor at Place Ville-Marie. The fund went broke, but the family wanted its money back, no matter what. The CEO of Norshield, John Kazanthidakis, was beaten bloody by three Rizzuto enforcers, who bragged about it later by phone.
I'm smarter than him. I'm not fucking stupid.
Yeah, he had a good 10, 12 stitches, eh? What did he hit him with, man?
When it's finished.
Fuck. He's fucking bleeding all kinds. The boardroom fucking floor over there.
Yeah, did he come in, though?
Not yet, no. He can't leave the boardroom because there's the girls there. They don't want him to see them. So he's got to wait till 5 o'clock to head for the hospital.
With those powers of persuasion, it's not surprising the Rizzutos have usually got their way, not only from international drug deals and big-time gambling, but also more modest sources. Local restaurant owners were threatened if they didn't use a specific brand of coffee the family distributed. Police say several hundred businesses, from hotels and pizzerias to grocery stores and car dealerships, paid protection money to the Rizzutos, starting at about $100 a month.
After 4 years of investigation, three of them with recording devices the Rizzutos somehow never found, Project Colisée had more than enough. November 22, 2006. In and around Montreal, hundreds of police officers descended on members of the Rizzuto family and their associates. Vito Rizzuto was incarcerated in the U.S., but his father was among the 91 arrested. Most would be convicted.